Hello, everybody. I know there's probably already people watching. I'm trying to get my... There I am. This way I can read your comments. Okay. 10 people. Woohoo! Hello! And of course, see, the iPad is sideways. I'm filming it correctly on my phone. The view screen is the right orientation. But on the iPad, I'm always sideways. I don't understand that. I'll flip it when I save it to YouTube. Hey everybody. Hey Lisa. So today, in case you didn't know, we're doing trees and landscape. I printed out a copy of the PDF document I created, which is available in my Etsy shop. It's a digital download. It's $2, and the colors are off on my copy because my printer was running out of ink. And so I used my husband's printer, and obviously his is running out of ink too. So, but anyway, this is a copy of the document, which includes, of course, a copy of the color key for my watercolor palette I'm going to use. And that way you have a complete list of all the colors in my palette. And copies of the two sample pieces of work that I did. So we are going to work on a couple of... we're going to do one little landscape, and then if we have time, we'll just do some trees. How is everybody today? Are you ready to paint with watercolor? Hello. I saved this because this is the palette of colors I used to make the original samples. And I just have a hard time just wiping that away and cleaning it off. Hey, Miss Jenny, how are you? So let's start with... the easier one of the two. Let me see if I... Hey! Somebody crafty. That's all I saw, because when I looked at the screen, you disappeared. I gotta pick a brush. Let's see. You know, I think I have too many brushes. I have trouble picking. you know what? I think if we're gonna start with the simpler one of the two, we're gonna start with this one. Hey, everybody. Hey, Michelle. This is a very suggestive sort of pine tree. This is a really, really easy one. Hey, how are you? Artzology's in the house. Cool. So I think that I'm going to use a flat brush. And I'm actually going to use this one. This is one of my favorite flat brushes. This is a Princeton Neptune, and this is a half inch flat. I really like this one for a number of reasons. I love the Princeton Neptune brushes, as you guys know. This one has a plastic handle. And I have a habit of leaving my brushes in water and forgetting they're in there. And so with the plastic handles, you don't worry about them cracking. So this is really cool. So we're going to start with the suggestive tree. And we're going to need the embossing tool for this, because we're going to want to dry... So the first thing I'm going to do is get my page wet, and I'm working today on this hot press watercolor paper. It's not my favorite paper. It's very smooth, and I know from playing with my watercolors for a while that I like a little bit of texture to my paper, and I really like cold press. That's a matter of preference, just like paint brands are. There's a lot of really great artist paint brands out there. You really just have to try them and see what you like. All right, so I'm going to start with some Hansa Yellow. And then some water. I didn't really clean my brush off really well, so it's got some yellow on it still. Because I wet the paper first, see, the paint is going to bleed all over the place. But that's what we want. I'm going to push this up a little bit so you guys can see it. There we go. That's better. But that's what we want for our background. We wanted something really suggestive of bright sunlight. Now I'm going to go into my palette where I have a little bit of this orange mixture. And I think this was like pyrrole orange, maybe with a little bit of permanent red. You'd have to look in my notes because I don't remember, to be honest with you. But I have it here, and I'm going to put it in here in the background a little bit. Just a little bit, not too much. And I'm going to sort of do a color no-no. So What do I mean by that? I'm going to add some blue into here. Now you want to do this carefully, because if you don't, you're going to get brown, because you're going to have all three of your primary colors on the page at the same time. And we don't want a brown sky. Hey, Mark! So I'm going to take some of my cobalt teal. Hey, Nina! And I'm going to, I have some on my brush. It's pretty wet and sloppy, and that's the way I want it. I'm going to flick it at my paper. Now we're going to dry it before everything blends too much and we get it brown, because we don't want a brown sky. I'm turning the paper and tilting it a little bit so I can see where it's shiny and really wet. And anything that's too wet and starts to blend too much, I'm going to lift with my rag. So yes, in answer to that question, what you could do is do the blue first, dry it, and then do the yellows and orange, and then dry it. For the sake of expediency, I'm not doing that. I also like to, like, do things in a hurry. I don't have any patience for anything. Okay, it's mostly dry. So, and you guys aren't on Periscope today to watch me dry paint. So, I rarely watercolor without my heat tool close by when I'm at home, because I don't have patience for paint to dry. Even with watercolor, even though it's water soluble, we're going to do some trees and landscapes today. Okay, so with watercolor, even though it's water soluble, if you layer your colors like you should when you're doing acrylic paint. What do I mean by that? So colors that are next to each other on the color wheel that blend well together, put those on the paper and then let it dry, and then you can put your other colors. So in this case, you could do the yellow and orange first and either dry it or let it dry, and then put the blue. The yellow and orange may still reactivate a little bit, but they're going to reactivate very little. And they're really not going to blend too much with the blue, and you won't get brown. So if you have a lot more patience than me, that is really the way to do this kind of a background. Something loose and suggestive to suggest the light. This is a not a realistic type of a painting in the least. So now I'm going to come in with more of my red color here, and I'm actually going to make some more. I'm going to put a little bit of permanent red in here, and I'm going to get some mostly pyrrole orange, which is one of my favorite orange colors. And now we're going to start to suggest our tree. And I'm working from the lightest and brightest colors to the darkest colors. So I've got my light yellows and light blues on here, and now we're going to go a little darker with the orange. the first thing I'm going to do with my flat brush is I'm going to draw my tree trunk, or I should say suggest my tree trunk. And I'm barely touching the brush to the paper, and it's not about making a perfect line. You want it kind of straight and parallel with the paper, but I mean, trees aren't necessarily parallel in real life, so I wouldn't worry too much about that. I'm going to suggest some landscape down here. Remember that this orangey red color is going to suggest lightness and brightness and warmth. Sunlight, that's what we want. Now I'm going to come in here with the tip of my brush, and I'm going to back and forth. I'm just tapping it on the paper, just like a zigzag. Wider at the bottom, narrower towards the top. You could do this with a filbert too, and the filbert will give you less straight, more curved branches. It's neither one of them is wrong. It's just a different look. I would encourage you to try it with both kinds of brushes. Now I'm just coming in here with some water. That was a little too much water. And that's going to allow some of the paint to blend. Thank you for the hearts. I love that. And it's going to smudge some of the marks a little bit. That's what I want. I want it to be suggestive. I just dipped my brush in the paint. That wasn't what I wanted. I think I should have more coffee. It's already been a weird morning. Okay, I'm going to do it down here just a bit. Okay, I like that. I'm going to look at my notes and see what I wrote in the notes. We can use new gamboge too, which is a bright orangey yellow color, and put some of that on here before we get too far into our darks. Now don't forget to put some of this on your trunk. So as you're adding your colors, you don't want to just do the branches, and you don't want to do everywhere, and you don't need to go on top of the same marks you already made. This is about suggesting your shapes and creating something that's interesting to the viewer, and it's really all about the marks and the colors and putting them in the kind of right place and just experimenting and playing, really. That was new gamboge. So now we're going to go in with some purples, but first I want to dry the oranges a little bit because I don't want to. If I make brown, that's okay, but I don't want to make too much brown. So I want to dry this just a little bit. Because I'm working on a watercolor block and I'm using my heat embossing tool, you'll see what's happening with the glue. And that happens. And my paper's warping a little bit, but I'm not too concerned. So I've got some different purples that I've already got over here on my palette. And this one is Rose of Ultramarine, which is a very red purple. So we're going to start with that one. And I'm going to put some on the trunk first, and this is the time where you really start deciding what is the shadow side of your tree. So I just decided that the left side was the shadow side, and that's where I put the purple. Now I'm going to tap some of this into my branches. I'm just using the tip of my brush. Don't dig any holes to China with your paintbrush. I'm also not gripping it, you know, tight like a pencil. In fact, the farther back you grip your brush, the less control you have, but the more suggestive marks that you make. So now we're going to rinse the brush off, and we're going to come in again with just some water. We like our marks. They're very suggestive, but that doesn't mean we need to leave all of them on there without letting some of them bleed and blend and smudge. And if you think about, maybe for some of you, it might be easier to think about the colors as working instead of from lighter to darker, what about warmer to cooler? So far we've used all pretty warm colors. Even the teal, if compared to other blues, is a warmer blue because it's a green. Let me know if you have any questions. So one of the reasons I'm here on Periscope every Wednesday is not just to show you these tutorials, but to answer your questions. Now I'm going to start to use one of my favorite Daniel Smith colors, Moon Glow. This is 140-pound hot press watercolor paper. This paper is by, let's see, Fluid? It's a Fluid hot press watercolor paper block. I found these blocks before at my art supply store and Hobby Lobby, but I think this one is from Dick Blick. Last time I placed an order, I wanted to get, you know, to the minimum to get free shipping, and I think I ordered paper. I'm pretty sure that's where this is from. So now I'm going to go to a cooler shade, and we're going to go with the Moon Glow, which is more of a gray, blue, purple. It's still purple. And you notice we've used no greens, and we're not going to be using greens. This is all about suggesting your tree with using warm and cool colors without actually using any realistic colors, because you don't, it's about suggesting the shape and the lightness and warmth without necessarily using cool, the realistic colors. And that's true for foliage and nature, as well as, you know, faces and things. Those of you who've seen me paint before know my favorite way to paint a face is to not use any realistic colors. Don't forget your landscape down here, because it wouldn't all be light and bright and warm. There'd be some dark spots. Alright, and so just like before, we're going to come in with some water. These kind of little quick tree studies are fun to do. They're great practice. Thank you. They're easy. And you learn a lot about what you can get your paint to do and to not do. And because you're not stressed about, you know, doing any realistic colors, you know, they're fun. It is very calming. I'm glad. It should be. Okay, so now we're going to introduce even cooler colors. So we're going to go in with a blue. I'm just looking at my notes to see what I used last time. I used what I thought I used. So we're going to go in with Prussian blue, which is a dark, it's a dark blue. It's a little bit on the, in my opinion, it's a little bit on the turquoisey side, but it's one of my favorite blues. We're going to use a little bit of that. Now, see, I just put a little bit of that dark color on there, and look how that tree is just starting to pop. Look at that. So you want to try to have, when you're doing this, a good balance of your really light colors and your really warm colors with your really darks. The darks are going to make your painting really pop. And the other thing, too, is if you're using a lot of brights, put some neutrals in there, because those neutrals are going to make those brights really pop. And I didn't dry it again, so my paint is mixing a little bit with the wet purples and things that are on here. I'm okay with that. Don't forget your, you know, little landscape or whatever it is that we've suggested here that's near the tree. Again, we're going to clean our brush off, and we're going to just get it wet. Now, the PDFs for these Watercolor Wednesdays are available in my Etsy shop for sale. They will continue to be available for sale. We are going to continue to have some version of Watercolor Wednesday for the new year. For as many Wednesdays as I can manage, I'll always announce them either the morning of or the day before. And it'll probably be more often than not, it'll be every Wednesday. I do think I'm going to do a paid-for class on Udemy that's just watercolor, sort of an in-depth thing where we make a watercolor journal and then we paint all the pages and we use a different technique on all the pages. So you guys tell me if that's something that you would be interested in. And then we would use our Watercolor Wednesdays to answer questions and do sign me up. Cool. I have to film it, so let me film it first. I have to film it and I've got to get it up on Udemy. So it's my project, one of my big projects to get ready. All right, so that's our blue. So look at that. That tree's really starting to pop. So now we're going to come in with some Payne's Gray, which is a dark bluish gray. I'm counting here which one of these, I think it's this one. Which one of these is Payne's Gray? It's good to have your color key handy so you can figure out which colors are which in your palette because some of them all look the same. So if you don't know, if you don't have a color key with your swatches, I would not know on some of these what color it is. So now this is the really dark color, and this is going to make it pop even more. So look at this dark, almost black color in here and how that makes that pop. And you don't need to put this everywhere, just put it in a few select places. Welcome to everybody who's just joining. And you have your oranges and yellows that are showing through the leaves of your tree here. So you're getting the impression of sunlight shining through the tree branches. And isn't that a lot of fun? Looking for the other one that I made the other day. I don't know what I did with it. You know, I keep putting artwork away and then I keep losing it. I don't know where it is right now. Oh, yes, I no, do I? Yeah, I might actually know where it is. So here's the one I did the other day when I was creating the PDF document. So that's just a simple, quick pine tree. Now you can, like I said, you can do these with a filbert brush. And if you don't know what a filbert brush is, and I'll show you a couple things. I wouldn't use this one because this is a little bit small. I would use one that's larger. I have an oval wash would work too. I may actually not have one that's big enough. So you want something that's rounded at the end. So this is a Lunar Blender. This is a Princeton Neptune brush. This is an oval wash. I'm sorry, this is Princeton Select. This is a Princeton Neptune. And you notice the same, this thing they have in common is they're both flat brushes, but they have rounded bristles at the end. This is a filbert. And I'm going to show you on a scrap of paper. Before we move forward, and let's just do it with the color that we have here on the palette. So let's just use. For the sake of you being able to see it, let's use the blue because it's a nice dark color. So again, you would do the same thing as I did with the flat. You would paint your trunk with the tip of the brush, just again, barely touching it to the paper. Then you're going to take your filbert brush, and just like we did with the flat, you're going to tap it to the paper and back and forth. But look at these marks that you get, these sort of rounded marks. It gives you the impression of a different kind of a tree. And this is a technique you can do not only in watercolor, but in acrylic paint. And if you layer your colors on top of each other, especially if you dry them in between, welcome everyone who's just joining. Then you get something that's really interesting, and it's definitely a different kind of a tree than doing the same basic brush strokes but with a flat brush. So I encourage you to try both. And now that I realize I don't have a wide filbert, I might need to get another one. When I use acrylics, actually, I don't... oh, cool. I don't water my acrylics down usually. I do paint half with heavy body and about half with fluid acrylics. Usually on the same canvas. But I don't water them down. All right, so now we're gonna work on something that incorporates a little smaller version of the tree that we just did and a different kind of a tree in a landscape. Now when I, oh, that sounds interesting. That would be fun at Christmas time to do on some Christmas cookies. When I painted this sample, I intended to start out by painting a true landscape. I ended up painting something that turned out to be more pond-like with landscape around it. So that's just what, you know, my muse was telling me to paint that day. So we're going to work on that. The one tip I will tell you about doing a landscape with water in it, whether it's a pond or it's an ocean, a seascape, whatever's above the water should be reflected in the water. Not necessarily perfectly reflected, but there should be an indication or hint of, say, this tree you can see here reflected a bit in the water, and over here where this sort of mountainy bushy shape is, there's a shadow right here. There's also some shadowing here where this tree is overhanging the pond. So you want to be conscientious of the fact that whatever's above the water should be reflected in the water. So we're going to switch to a round brush. Let's see. I'm going to switch to this one. This is a round number 4. Now, when I started with the sample, I actually started out by using Moon Glow, a very light wash of Moon Glow, I think. Wait, let me look at my notes. See, it was a week ago. I don't remember. That's so terrible. I know. Oh, see, no, that's not true either. So I mixed some Prussian blue. With a little bit of Payne's gray. We'll do it right here. Some phthalo yellow green, which is this kind of bright green. A little bit of sepia. We're looking, we're shooting for a grayish blue. Of course you could use a color that's in your palette. Of course you could. But it's more interesting and more fun to mix your own. Okay, and then we're gonna add some water so we get kind of a thinner mixture. And then you wanna start to outline your shapes. So the first thing I started with is the big tree trunk. And it's not about getting a perfect exact shade, just start with a lighter shade. Something that's sort of a grayish, greenish, grayish, bluish, something that's, you know, a little more interesting than just, you know, plain old anything. All right, and then I'm going to put my horizon line in. Now, in the PDF, and let's ask you guys live online, Do you notice an error in this? A problem with this? There's a blatant mistake in here. It works because of other things on here, but there's a mistake. Welcome. So when you create a painting, any painting, you don't want your focal image, whatever it is, to be smack in the middle of the piece. That's really boring and uninteresting. You usually, especially when you're talking about a landscape, you want your horizon line to be above or below the center of the canvas. If you think of your canvas in sort of a grid of thirds, so vertical thirds and horizontal thirds, where those 4 point, yeah, exactly, it's in the center of the page. So where those four those lines meet, those 4 points, that's kind of where you want your focal points to be, or where they should be near. So when you put your horizon line in, it should be in the lower third or the upper third of the canvas. In this case, it's not so bad because we have this big tree right here, and it kind of draws attention away from the horizon line being smack in the middle. But that's actually a mistake, and if I was going to sell this, I would mat it or crop it so that I would cut some of it off somewhere, because it's actually a mistake. So when you put your horizon line in, you want to pick a spot that's above or below the center of the canvas. So in this case, let's put it... Now, if you're doing a seascape and you want it to be all about the ocean, you want to put it above. But if you're doing maybe a landscape where it's, in this case, about the trees, then you want to maybe put it below. So I'm going to put it down in the bottom. I'm just using the tip of my brush. If it was a landscape, I'd be less worried about this line being straight because maybe it's bushy. If it's water, you want this line to be pretty straight, because where the water meets the sky is going to be a pretty straight level line. So now I'm going to come in here and I'm going to sort of map in my smaller tree that's in the distance. I'm just putting in my shapes right now. And then I think I'm going to do something right here again, and I'm going to pull in my flat brush, and I think I'm going to put some kind of land mass-ish kind of shape right here. Yeah, that looks good to me. Then I'm going to come over here and I'm going to start putting in more details to this tree trunk. You know, lines in the bark, because the bark is, you know, wavy and crinkly and, you know, not even. Oh, good. Yes, I encourage all of you out there who want to start painting and never have before, or maybe it's been a while, do it. Do it, do it, do it. Life is too short not to do what you love. Okay, and we're just kind of roughly mapping in our shapes. I'm going to come down here to our little tree and suggest some little branches down here. Welcome everybody who's just joining. Right? You could even go so far as to like put some shapes here. Oh, that's such a loaded question. So both mediums can be expensive. It depends on you know, what kind of paint that you end up buying. Watercolors are, some of them are very expensive, but so are acrylics. I would say that watercolors, to get started, they're less messy, in my opinion. I started with watercolor, and watercolor is very portable and not messy. So in that respect, I think it's a little easier to get started with watercolor, and they do seem to go longer. And also with watercolor, you don't have to worry about them going bad in the tube. If they dry out in the tube, and I have a friend, Jerry Bellini, and I don't know that she's on here right now. If she is, Jerry, say hi, from my Arts and Parts. And she did a YouTube video recently where she took her mom's old watercolors that were dried up in the tube, and using some gum arabic revived them. She peeled the tube back from the watercolor to pull the pigment out, and then crushed it up and added some gum arabic to it and repotted it in a new pot, and that worked just great. So, it's watercolor, so for the most part they can be revived. When acrylics go bad in the tube, that's you're out of luck. They're just bad. So now, while we're gonna let this all dry a little bit, and we're gonna actually turn this around so I can work on the sky. Gonna use the filbert brush. I'm gonna use the Prussian blue. Because I've got it here. You could use ultramarine blue. You could use a combination of the two mixed together. I could grab some ultramarine over here, which is more of a true blue. Whatever blue you want for the sky. We're gonna do some in the sky. And what you really want to do the sky before you get too far with the tree, because you don't want to have to go back and touch up the sky and work around the tree. I think watercolor is more forgiving. I agree with you. Now, in your sky, the farther away from the earth it is, the darker it is. So start by laying out your pigment up at the top. Bring in some water. And I take that back. I'm going to use the flat because I'm really. Bring in some water before you get too far. I put these on my YouTube channel. If you go to YouTube and you search GinaBErrens.com, I'm sorry, Gina B. Aarons. Holy cow, I need more coffee. You will find these videos there, and I've created a playlist that is just for recorded on Periscope. This dried a little bit, so I'm not gonna freak out. I'm gonna get it wet, and I'm gonna add some more paint. And you notice I'm leaving white spots because that's gonna hint at, it being a little bit of a cloudy sky. I like that. I almost never do just plain blue skies. Oh, good. Yeah, it'll be on YouTube. It takes me like the whole day to get the video set this so that it can be on YouTube. There's a little bit of a process I go to get you guys the best quality that I can, because this is being filmed with my iPhone, and it's not a huge picture. It doesn't take up the whole screen, so but I will get it. I will be downloading it and working on it this afternoon. So I'm going up to the back up to the top, and the paint is still wet, and I'm just laying in a little bit more pigment. I'm going to grab some ultramarine, and it's going to blend a little bit with what's on here because it's wet. I want that, and I want it to be a little darker up here. Add some more water. Don't be afraid to get your rag in and do some lifting if you get too much pigment. Do it right away. Know that if you're using artist grade watercolors, they're going to stain, so you may not be able to get all of the paint up, and some colors stain more than other colors. So that looks pretty good. I like that. So now, remember what I said about whatever is above the water being reflected in the water. So let's take some more of our blue. Do it. I say do it. So I'm going to put a little bit of the same sky blue in the water. And I say, in my opinion, if you're debating about whether to start back in painting and to start doing it with watercolor, you're welcome. Or acrylic, I would say go with the watercolor. Watercolor is really my favorite. If I had to grab one art supply because my house was on fire, it'd be my watercolors. Hey, Carol. So now I have some of the sky reflected down where the water is going to be. So I'm going to let that dry a little bit, and then let's work on our trees. We'll go back to our round brush. I might want a bigger round brush. For a long time. I never tried them yet. Oh, see, you have to try them. And you know how I learned? I get asked a lot if I took any. I've never taken a watercolor class live or online. I've read a lot of watercolor books and I've done a lot of playing. Yep, so do that. You need to do that. So just get your paints out and play and have some fun. I'm going to switch to a larger round brush because I really want to be suggestive with my marks. Let's see. Let's use this one. It's a Royal and Langnickel. You're welcome. Okay, so I'm going to go with some greens. What greens did I use last time? Oh, green gold and cascade green. So green gold is a more olivey green than the phthalo green. This is the phthalo green. It's really kind of bright. And then this is the green gold, which is more olivey. I used green gold and I used this cascade green, which is a very blue green. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to come up here to the big tree. And I'm going to, and this is a larger brush. This is a round. This is a number 10. This is a Royal and Langnickel. And I'm just dabbing. You notice I'm just dabbing. Christmas here. There you go. Yeah, I usually ask for gift cards for Christmas. People don't know what to give me. I'm all, just give me a gift card because I could tell you what art supplies I want till the cows come home, but you probably won't get me the right one. And that way, if they get me a card and I, run out of something, a color or something, I have it during the year and I can just replace it easily. So then I went and wa rinsed my brush off, and I'm just, this is just water. And that's letting the pigment sort of move around. I'm not trying to cover up my brush marks because they're going to hint at leaves. And I want that. And I'm not worried about it mixing with the blue in the sky because it'll just make more green colors. So I'm going to take some more of the same green, only I'm just going to try to get a little bit last time. I mean, last time, this time. Last time I got too much, and this was wet down here when I did the sample. So then it just blended into the sky, which was okay, but it wasn't what I wanted. So I'm going to come in here with just the tip of my brush. I'm going to put some of this green here over this suggestive little tree that we've got going on here. Maybe a little bit down here. And maybe a little bit suggested in the water because remember what I said about what's above the water would be reflected in the water, right? And then don't forget about this little thing over here. Put some dots on there to suggest like foliage or bushes or, it's not really a tree. We don't want it to be a tree, but we don't necessarily want it to just look like a rock either. And this brings your color all around the page so that you don't just have it in one spot. And I just lifted some of the color because I thought there was too much. I'm going to take a stronger amount of the pigment here and I'm going to put a little bit more on this tree. This is still wet, so it's going to blend and bloom a bit, and I want that. Okay. That's nice. So now I'm going to come in and I'm going to don't worry so much about actually painting the realistic rock, suggest your rock. When I first started learning, it drove me crazy because I couldn't get it perfect to the way I wanted. Yes, that means I'm probably a perfectionist, but I realized being suggestive about my shapes made me much happier and much freer to just play with my supplies, and that made me much more happy. So that's what I do. Okay, so before we get too much farther, let's put some more color in our tree trunk. I am going to use some of the colors I have on my palette, but not just of that, just them. One of the colors I want to introduce is Moon Glow, which is our purple color. Just because you're using green in your tree doesn't mean you can't suggest and use other colors, in your painting. Yeah, that would be fun. I've always wanted to do a really big painting, something huge. So this is Moon Glow, and again, I'm just running it kind of roughly down with the tip of my round brush on the trunk, on and nearby the other marks that I made. I do sometimes mix my own colors, but I know how to mix my own colors, but it's not my favorite thing. So this is just water. Some artists really only use like a 12 color palette. I was watching an artist on YouTube this morning, and he really just uses a 12 color palette and he mixes all of his own colors. And that's really, some artists love that. I am not one of those. I really just like to paint. And so if I can do that and not have to worry about mixing colors all the time, that doesn't mean I don't know how. It just means it's not my favorite thing. I'm keeping the water when I put it on here. That would be fun. When I put the water on here, I'm keeping it inside the tree trunk so that the moon glow stays in the tree trunk. I'm going to put some of it here, some of it in the water, some of it over here. Just do some dabbing. You're going to get some of the unexpected happen if you don't do drying in between. You're going to get, you know, this purple color mixing with the green and making it brown. We're doing a landscape, so those colors would be there anyway, and working with the unexpected that happens with watercolor, well, in my opinion, that's one of the fun things of working with watercolor. I'm going to put some down here. We're going to let all that dry a little bit, and we're going to come back up here to the tree, and I'm going to add my darker cascade green. I also paint in acrylic. Masking fluid, you mean? So yes, and in the online course, I think I'm going to, one thing we're going to do in the online course that we're looking to develop for the new year is I think that we're going to make a watercolor journal out of some paper, watercolor paper, and then we're going to paint, do a lesson on each page, so by the end of the class you'll have a full book of watercolors. And I think with each lesson we'll focus on a different watercolor technique. One of them is going to be using masking fluid, one of them will be wax resist, one of them will be using plastic wrap, one of them will be using salt, and that sort of thing. And by the end of the class you'll have a good repertoire of different techniques you can do with your watercolors. And we'll probably do one that's just focused on blending and, you know, puddles of watercolor color, and how you can get that to work for you instead of against you. Hey, Dory. So now I'm just putting in some of my color and then putting in some water. I forgot what I was doing there for a second. Okay. And then I'm going to put some in my little tree here. Put some in my water because, you know, I said that whatever's above would be reflected in the water, right? And put some over here. Some in the water. And get in here with my just plain water, just on my brush, no paint. So you can lift some with just a damp brush and then dry it off. And with your lighter colors, your light yellows, your light yellow greens, mostly they'll lift almost completely. Your darker colors won't. Yeah, this is a hot pressed watercolor block. It's actually not my favorite. See how the paint and water is really kind of going everywhere, and I really like painting with cold press because you have all the nooks and crannies and the little divots in the paper. And for me, not only does that give my painting something interesting to look at in the background besides the paint, but it's a little easier for me to control where the paint goes, in my opinion. Yes, I do. And a lot of times that when I'm doing the sky, I actually earlier, if you didn't see it, I turned it upside down. But sometimes I even work with the paper tilted when it's just me and I'm not on camera, and that lets the paint flow down, and you get these interesting drips. I'm gonna switch back to my smaller round brush. Thank you. And we're gonna continue working on our tree trunk here. I'm gonna actually dry this up here a little bit because I want to work on the branches that are in amongst those leaves. Yes, I am a big fan of Jean Haynes. If y'all don't know who she is, look her up. She's got some really great books. You can get them on Amazon. They're fabulous, and I would recommend them to anybody. So I'm going to use the colors on my palette. You can use purples, browns. This was Moon Glow, but then some of the green mixed in it, so I don't know what color it is now, but we're gonna use it. And now it's kind of a reddish orangey purpley color, but we're gonna use it. Yeah, so you don't. I love watercolor because you can't control it. So I'm going to come in here with the tip of my little brush, and I'm going to make some of these hint of branches back here darker. I'm not going to make all of it darker. I'm going to leave some of it light. And every time you do this, it's going to come out slightly different. So naturally, where I have these sections that naturally turned dark, then I'm going to take my paint and I'm going to work with those and I'm going to emphasize them and make them darker. And the ones that are light, we'll leave light and we'll let them be the lighter parts of the tree. Yeah. So the other colors I used in the tree trunk were also some sepia, which is a brown. A very dark brown. I love my watercolor pencils. I've got twinkling H2Os. Water soluble media is really my thing. So this is one of our dark colors. So this is really going to make things start to pop. This is the sepia, the dark brown. One of my favorite browns in any palette, whether it is watercolor or acrylic. This is a good painting trees and tree bark is a good exercise to do when you've had too much coffee because tree branches aren't straight. So if your hands are a little shaky, that's okay. So with pencils, it really depends on the kind of pencils you have. You have more control about where the paint goes, but then when you get it wet, it really does blend. They're just a completely different medium. I use them a lot in conjunction with each other. I'll make a lot of times do my initial sketch in watercolor pencil and then go over it and start to define the shapes in the watercolor paint. And there's no reason you can't do that and sort of, in one respect, to do a mixed media piece, but do it with all water soluble materials. They're very different. So I'm going to take the same sepia color. I'm going to put some here. And then again in the water because we've got to put it in the water. I'm going to put some down here. Okay, I'm gonna put some over here on our like rocky shape. And then what's reflect above would be reflected in, right? So we're going to put some here. And water. So these reflections that are in the water would be a little bit blurry. They wouldn't necessarily be, you know, true to form. That's pretty good. Looking at my notes. So I'm going to go in and I'm going to use some Moon Glow, my favorite color. Moon Glow. I love this color. I'm going to do it over here because my plate is a little bit messy. So when your palette or your plate or your mixing area gets really messy like that, you can of course choose to just leave it that way. You can re-wet it and do another painting with it. You can also wipe it off, and one of the fun things to do is just get it really wet and then wipe it off with like a coffee filter and stain a coffee filter with this leftover paint or something like that, and then dry it, and then you can use that in your mixed media. Okay, so this is Moon Glow. And you just keep layering your dark colors. You could use Prussian Blue. Hey, Patty. You can use Neutral Tint, which is a dark gray. It's a very transparent color. It really neutralizes the brightness in your other colors. I like it as a color all on its own. So I'm just taking the Moon Glow and I'm dabbing it in across my painting in the areas that would be darker. See, the only problem with me painting in front of the camera, you guys who have watched me enough now on Watercolor Wednesday know this. Oh, cool. Yeah, there'll be a replay and also I'll put it on YouTube. Is I get so involved in what I'm painting, I forget to talk. Because I just love to paint. So that's pretty good. This is paper. This is hot press watercolor paper. So I'm going to take some Payne's Gray now. Which is our dark blue gray, and it's more interesting color to use than black, which is why I like to use it. I'm going to put a little bit of it in our tree. So I do. I'm here on Periscope. I'm on YouTube. I teach with CrazyIslandUniversity.com. And there's a few different things on there, including art journaling. I'm also going to be having a watercolor course that comes out January of next year. I say that, but it might be a little later because I haven't actually started filming it yet. I have to do that. I need an assistant. One that knows how to edit video. So I'm barely touching my brush to the tree trunk. I prefer both. That's the easy answer. Holy cow. So this palette I'm using, these are Daniel Smith watercolors. There's a PDF for this class that's available in my Etsy shop. Daniel Smith is my preferred brand, although I have other brands that I like. Including Van Gogh. I like to squeeze the tubes out into a palette like this, into pans. And that's my favorite way to work with my watercolors. And both my palette I use here in the studio and my travel palette are in these metal boxes. I think it's easier to mix your paints in these metal boxes than it is on a plastic palette. You need to just get some brushes and some paints and some paper. You can watch these replayed episodes on YouTube. and you can follow along. There are PDF downloads available, like I said, in my Etsy shop, and there in those is notes, step by step with pictures that I created when I did the samples for the previous for that week's class. You can find me on Facebook. I have a Facebook group called A Life of Art and Self-Expression. And that way, if you get stuck on something, you can ask me. And I will, like I said, I will be on Udemy, and there will be a course on Udemy. And in there, you'll have access to, you know, discussions and all that stuff. You can just get crazy with drawing branches in here. So, and I tend to do that. So you want to try to not do that. I try to get crazy sometimes with the little branches. Because you could just keep going up here. But to start painting in watercolor, you just need some paints and some paper and a brush. You really don't need anything fancy. A round brush and a flat brush. A palette of paints. It doesn't have to be a big expensive palette. One of my favorite paints is Van Gogh watercolors. You can get them at Hobby Lobby and the tubes are not that expensive. Exactly. So the first thing I do when I buy any watercolor paints is I make one of these color keys to go with that palette of paints that I just bought. It really is the only way to see how those colors are going to be true to your paper when you're painting. And if you don't have that, it can be really difficult to pick the right color. Okay, I like that. We need to do some work down here, but first I want to dry all this because I don't want this to get too smudgy. Okay, so yeah, the first thing I do when I buy or create a palette of paints is I make a color key. It's the very first thing I always do. So now I'm going to use some of my Payne's Gray, and I'm going to just, you know, I'm going to utilize what's on my palette, which is different than I think what it says in the notes, but I'm going to utilize what's on here, and I'm going to make sort of a version of Payne's Gray using what's on my palette. And I'm going to take this color. That's a good idea. I'll work on that today. So if you go to Facebook or YouTube and you search for my name, Gina B. Aarons, the same name that's on here on Periscope, you'll find me. In fact, if you just go to Google and put my name in, you're going to find me all over the place. So I'm going to take this dark color I created out of what was on my palette. And the first thing I'm going to do is put it here underneath a tree around this sort of bushy shape that I created. And then I'm going to add some water and I'm going to just blend it out just a bit. Okay, I like that. I'm going to add a little bit more right here. I'm going to do something similar over here. So basic color blending theories work with watercolor as well as acrylic paint and any paint. So that, what does that mean? So if you blend all your primary colors together, you're going to get a neutral. So I had yellow, green, blue, yellow, blue, red on here all at the same time. So if you mix all of these together, you're going to get a neutral. It's going to be in the red family because of there was so much red on here. But you're going to get like a neutral gray color. See? So you should know that. That's one of the basics you should know about color blending. So I'm going to come back over here to the Payne's Gray. And I'm going to mix it with a little bit of Moon Glow. Start with this horizon line. And then water. When I first started painting, doing paintings in both watercolor and acrylic, I immediately started painting water. It's always been my favorite. I don't know what that means. That was not in English, so I'm not sure what that means. And I'm going to just blend it towards the middle with just water. I'm going to take some of my cobalt teal, which is one of my other favorite Daniel Smith colors, because, like, who wouldn't love that color? Like, honestly. Sorry. And I'm going to put a little bit of this in our pond water. And this other colors are wet, so look at what happens. And I'm going to stick to the areas of the pond that are lighter with this color. They'll blend a little bit into the darker colors, but look at that. Isn't that fabulous? How do you not just like that? And every time you paint this, it's going to come out slightly different, but that's okay. And they're a lot of fun, and you can try different shapes of trees, but now you have some basics. See, I love painting the water. There's just something peaceful about painting the water. So here's the other sample that I did when I created the PDF document. And you can keep going with this and make things darker and darker, or brighter and brighter. You can add some more dark to this rocky area. Painting deserts is fun too. I know every time I go to Las Vegas, I try to not only take lots of inspiration photos, but do some painting. I love to go to Red Rock Canyon. Any of you that are in or have been near Nevada, Red Rock Canyon is just gorgeous. Does anybody have any questions about painting trees? You could totally do this as a landscape, and instead of doing pond water, do something that's suggestive of maybe a grassy field. You could put a, you know, little suggestion of a building in the background, and you could do it very easily. So let's take our Payne's Gray. And put a little bit of it on there, and suggest something that's man-made is really easy. So with all these wonky, unusual, not geometric shapes, the best way to suggest something that's man-made is to put in a geometric shape in there somewhere. And that, then they'll go, oh, there's a little building there. Okay, see you later. So then they know, oh, well, look at that. There's a little building right there. It's just a matter of practice. If I can make it look easy, if I can do this, you guys can do this. You got to trust me on that one. So just get fun, have fun with it, and just do some playing. There you go. Something quick, something easy. It doesn't have to be, you know, Picasso. You're just practicing and playing and having fun and trying your techniques. So I will work today on next week. I think we're doing flowers. Bird of Paradise, I think, was suggested. Now, if you guys do go to my Facebook group, again, it's called A Life of Art and Self-Expression. If you go over there and go into the files tab, there is a couple of Watercolor Wednesday documents. On one of them, we take viewer suggestions for upcoming episodes. So, you can go and add to that whatever you would like to see on the, an upcoming episode. Next week, I think we're doing Bird of Paradise flowers. And we will, I've got to go Google some sample images and then work on the PDF this afternoon. So, I will be doing that later today. And if you have any questions, comments, or concerns, you can find me on Facebook, and you can always email me. Thank you. I'm glad you could be here too. This Periscope, of course, will be here for 24 hours, and I will be downloading it and putting it up onto YouTube. Along with the bonus footage that I filmed to create these. I do film it with my camera, and I'll be attaching that to the end of the YouTube video from today's episode. All right, you guys, have a great day. Don't forget the most important thing. Go out and do something nice for yourself because you deserve it. I'll see you guys next week. Bye. Oh, good, Mark. You're welcome. Post it to the Facebook group. All right, I'll see you guys later.